I pitched Arnold the idea for End of Days, and because I didn't think it would be interesting to do the film with anybody else. And he was interested in the idea, so I wrote it very much with him in mind. But I wanted to do some different things with his character. We've always seen Arnold as the action hero, a larger-than-life character. I wanted to take that and bring it down to a more human level, show him a little bit more down and out. And take him on a more character-oriented journey in the middle of an action movie.
In this movie, we face the challenge of being an action thriller, that Arnold has to be a real person. He's not a robot. His skin is not made of metal, but he's a real person. So his character in this movie has a great range of emotions that he has to go through. He's a man that has been beaten up by his environment.
When we meet him, he's at the bottom of his grief. And every day is a hard day to get through. He's lost faith and he's lost the meaning in his life. And really all he has is a friend. He just has Chicago, you know, Kevin Pollak.
I think this is unlike anything Arnold Schwarzenegger has ever done, because it leans more towards the dramatic, scary, creepy, dark, haunting images with action.
I guess in this movie, for the first time, he's fighting the demons from within himself. So it's not like there's, there is a foe out there who is the devil, but he also is fighting interior demons. And I think the part requires him to be more emotional as an actor than maybe people have seen in some of his other action pictures.
Painful reality is.
No!
This is a film where the action sequences work because they're sequences about a man who is in jeopardy. It's Arnold Schwarzenegger actually in jeopardy during these sequences. It's Arnold Schwarzenegger actually losing in some of these sequences. So he plays probably the most vulnerable character he's ever played and the most accessible and touchable character.
You wish entrance?
Yes.
You have much hatred and vengeance in your heart. You may pass.
End of Days was a fantastic script. I was involved with it for 2 years. When Andrew Marlowe came to me, when I was vacationing in Hawaii, and he came to me and says, I have a great idea where you can fight something that is much bigger than anything you've ever fought in your whole life on a screen. I said, what's that? He says, the devil, Satan. So I looked at my wife and I said, sounds good to me.
The most difficult challenge of all for me as a producer is deciding on the director. Jim Cameron, who's one of Arnold's best friends, called me and said, I have a guy who I think could direct this movie brilliantly. And he said, come on over and see me. And I went over and met with Jim and Arnold. And Jim really sold us on Peter.
I've seen his work in the past, but I also at the same time realized that he has never really given the opportunity to do something that big and that important. And I was the first one to say, let's give Peter this opportunity because he's so talented and he's so creative and he's so wonderful with the camera and with the lighting and all those things and also the way he directs actors.
He is one of those guys who's a jack of all trades. He's his own cinematographer. He's the director. He has edited movies in the past. He doesn't edit this movie, but he has. He's very knowledgeable about the making of a movie.
My theory about acting, my theory about design, my theory about film editing, my theory about all the elements of making movies is basically get the smartest, most talented bunch of people you can possibly get, make sure they're incredibly strong-willed, make sure that they don't just listen to you, that they have their own opinions, and nurture that so that you bring out the best in them.
End of Days is actually a more difficult project to write for me than other screenplays, because you're dealing with supernatural elements. And we're doing something a little bit different in this movie. We're taking something like The Exorcist, a movie of that type with those overtones, and we're melding it with the action genre. So we're doing a supernatural thriller with action.
Originally, the script was written that in the end, I will blow the devil away. And something in my instincts in me told me that there is something wrong about that ending. So we asked various different religious leaders about some advice. But the one priest by the name of Father Fregamini, we asked him, because he studies this so much, if he can help us and look at the script and have a meeting, a brainstorming session.
When we were first talking about this story, Arnold called me one day and asked me and the writer to come over to his house. And we said, okay, why? And he said, I want you to tell the story to my priest, Father Fregamini. And the writer and I drove over to Arnold's house and we went, oh my God, you know, we're gonna have to tell the story of Satan coming and walking the earth in search of his mortal bride to give birth to the Antichrist. And then the priest is gonna be there and he's gonna look at us and he's gonna go, what have you done? So we literally told him the whole story. We acted it out, we did dialogue, we did, you know, everything. And he just watched us very like pleasantly, and you know, I never was sure what was going on in the back of his mind. And then when we were done, he went, I love this story. This is fantastic. This is great. I only ask one thing of you, because the ending is Arnold, all the firepower in the world, fighting Satan. And he says, is there a way that you can defeat Satan without all the firepower, without all the weapons, without all the shooting and the killing? And we went, well, we'll try to work on that.
The big challenge for Andrew Marlowe was at this point now, how do you create a spectacle of an ending with making it an ending that has to do with having faith and beating the devil with faith? How do you show that visually? And the message itself is just extraordinary, I think, especially for someone like myself who has always solved every problem with the weapon.
Story has you know, a historical and biblical antecedents, and it has rich lore in cinema history. The Exorcist, Omen, Silence of the Lambs. I mean, it's you know, drenched in that. And you know, even if you look back on all the Dracula movies, you know, there is a, you know, a satanic kind of, you know, the man with the collar turned up and the Nosferatu things. It's like, it's the evil one.
All the different religions of the world are knowing the fact that the devil is going to come, and they try to figure out in which form is he going to come back, how is he going to come back, which country is he going to come back, how do we know he manifests himself. Is it through the wars that are building? Is it through the unrest, the social unrest? Is it through the violence that we see? Is it through people going less to church all of a sudden? Are there more devil worshippers out there? All of those things, everyone is looking for signals.
You know, we could have made a modern version of Satan walking in the streets, but we wanted to not do that. We wanted to have fire, and we wanted to have candles, and we wanted to have you know, the icons of the devil throughout history. We didn't want to create the postmodern devil.
Gabriel Byrne is one of the greatest actors I've ever seen in my life. One of the most serendipitous men I've ever met. Women react with this reflex when you say that Gabriel Byrne's in the movie, that the kind of reflex that makes me jealous, frankly, because just all these women get dewy about him. And then when you spend time with him, you understand why.
I've always thought he was a really great actor, and he does have that. When you say his name to women, they all blush and smile.
Christine, you know who I am. I've come for you.
There has to be something alluring about the bad guy. And I think that there certainly had to be some sort of attraction between my character and he to make the story work, because she needed to be torn. And I think when somebody's sort of that charming in a really dark way, you can understand it. I mean, we all liked bad boys that smoked cigarettes and rode motorcycles. It's like, he's the ultimate that. It's heightened reality.
I'm gonna hurt you so bad you're gonna beg to die. But I'm not gonna let you. It's not gonna be that easy. You're mine, and I want you to see what's gonna happen.
Gabriel's a very interesting actor. He brings a lot of intensity to a role, and he's the kind of actor who has the range to be your best friend, to be very chummy with you, but then in a moment, he can turn, and there's this brooding, this seething. You can see him sticking a knife into you, and I think that kind of acting portrays a really great and really interesting Satan.
I had always kind of resisted the idea of playing, you know, a villain, the stock kind of villain. But if you're going to play a villain, you might as well play the king of all villains, which is the devil, and you might as well do it in a Schwarzenegger picture. A lot of people have a preconception of what they imagine the devil to be, and the challenge was in trying to go against that perception, and I wanted him to be a light and humorous and ironic, and at the same time be cool.
What the hell are you?
First thing, when an actor first reads the script, he's looking to see how good his part is. And then if he likes the part, he then begins to see, I always want to know, you know, how good the overall script is. And then I see if the script is credible.
Arnold knew Rod and asked him to come on in, and Rod Steiger showed up, and he came in and he said, I'm here, I'll audition, I'll read, I'll do whatever you want, I want to do this. And it was like Rod Steiger wanting to do our movie. It was like, you know, he didn't have to audition, he didn't have to do any of those things, but he's still an actor.
The thing in this role is to portray this person as a human being who also happens to be a priest, because it seems, whether you know it or not, the cliché image of a priest sneaks into a performance, and you find yourself saying, well, my child, that's perfectly all right. God will be with you.
We are preventing the end of days.
But you can't prevent evil by doing evil.
Arnold had seen a film that I did called Niagara, Niagara. And I went in to meet him, and he was really generous. And I was terrified, but I was too afraid to show that, so I just was a big smart aleck. And, you know, just kind of started, like, goofing around with him. And he was really warm. And you kind of forget to be scared with him because he gives so much and he's so funny.
We'd interviewed several young women to be this role, and Robin Tooney, when she came in after about 15 minutes in the room, we knew it was her. So Robin was actually the second person to get on board, and she met with Arnold, and Arnold loved her, and the two of them together in the room was rather amazing, because Arnold's rather a big guy and she's a rather petite young woman, and so it was kind of interesting. But she's like a tough New York chick who told Arnold right in the room that she always loved his work and always wanted to work with him, and that she would not put up with anything from him at all because she would stand up to him. That was great.
I'd feel a lot better if you showed me how to use one of those things. I want to do something. Let me help.
All right, here. Here, take the gun. Line up the side with your target. Uh-huh. Beware of the recoil. Here's the magazine. Put it in. Load. Only pull the trigger when you're ready.
My
like that.
As a young actor, it's really fun to watch different people's processes because you're still learning. I mean, to watch how they cope and how they deal and how they approach a scene is really interesting. And Kevin Pollak, who comes from comedy and from a completely different world, approaches his work in a much different way. And he's so funny all the time. I mean, it's unbelievable. We'll be about to roll and he'll start telling polar bear jokes. I tell his jokes to people all the time. They're really good jokes.
You know, when I got a job, thanks to, you know, my agent and Jackie Birch, the casting woman, and Peter Himes ultimately saying, ooh, ooh, him, get him. I had 2.5-3 weeks most before I had to start working. And I pictured myself standing next to Arnold on the screen, and I'm gonna disappear. So I had two choices, you know, hit the weights immediately or grow facial hair. Because I had to butch it up, let's be honest. So what I did was I grew facial hair because the gym is just so weird. You know, plus you have to lift weights and I hate that. And then you get to the set and Arnold has an 18-wheeler filled with workout equipment. And I just walk by every day when he's in there eating a donut and go, how's it going? Okay, man. Keep pumping, brother.
Looking good.
Tell me you remembered. Come on. Get up, you pussy.
And if you see people in a situation and you don't believe the situation to be real, you won't be frightened for them. If you see people in a situation and you kind of identify with it and you believe it's actually happened, then you can scare the wits out of people. So I thought that the film, first, last and foremost, had to be stunning to look at, and it had to be, it had to have a visual credibility to it so that you looked at it and you go, oh, that could be really happening. So I wanted it to be dramatic. I wanted a series of colors and tones that to me were emotional. The wardrobe is basically shades of black, gray, and brown. The lighting and the sets are all tones of grays and golds and ambers. So the light is extremely warm, muted. The colors are not saturated. And hopefully there's an atmosphere in it.
Peter's very good. He gives me a lot of free license. So what I do is I give him an illustration of what I feel the set should look like. And then he gives you know, like me, his suggestions, what he would like specifically within that set. As an example, in the script, we needed an altar area. And I actually came up with some reference on Chernobyl. And I got some photographs, some fabulous photographs, of the big old generators there and everything, and all the heating rods. And I thought that that could be like an idyllic setting for the altarpiece. But then, of course, we had the added problem, because we was in a building, an existing structure, we had a lot of explosions going on. We had to get the fire marshal involved. So the problem with that was, is that we couldn't have any candles on the ground level. So the consequences of that was, how was we gonna light the set? Because I knew Peter wanted to light the set with just candles. So I came up with this idea of these huge candelabras. Not small ones, but huge, you know, 9-10 foot tall. And to fill them with hundreds and hundreds of candles. Therefore, being able to see our set and be able to kind of like make a dramatic, interesting looking scene.
Ready and action.
In the movie, there will be huge, you know, fires, and we have huge explosions, and we have, you know, huge subway crashes, and where subway cars derail and blow up, and we have huge weapons and confrontations with weapons and shootouts. There's a lot of that in there, but it's not done like an action movie. It's done in a different way.
What makes it difficult is that the visual effects in this film are trying to enhance reality. They're trying to look like they're actually happening. It's not about fancy. It's not about something that takes place in a galaxy far, far away. So what makes it difficult is to try to make them all convincing.
Yeah.
because so much of it is technical, obviously I left all that to Peter, who did a brilliant job marshalling all these effects together and putting all this, doing all these explosions and just incredibly complex and intricate scenes together. But as I said, from an acting point of view, I wasn't really required to be involved that much in the technical end of it. My character just really causes destruction, dresses cool, and has sex with people, and is just about destroying the world, that's all, really.
In this shot, the man comes out of the restaurant, and as he does so, as he exits, there's a big explosion. The explosion engulfs him, and then he walks out of the explosion unscathed. So that's what we're creating, and obviously you can't have a real guy in there, he'll be burned up. So we're shooting it in two passes. We're shooting the explosion of the restaurant, and then we're going to be shooting Gabriel Byrne on a blue screen, and then those will be later composited in, so the final appearance will look as if he really did come through and out of the flames.
So there's a third pass that we shot a couple nights ago as well, when we decided to lock the camera off across the street. From that position, we got shots of the people eating in the restaurant, people kind of walking around the restaurant, so that when the explosion actually happens, it'll look like there really are people in there, live people walking around, as opposed to the mannequins that we have in there right now. And we will, when we composite the shot together, we'll transition very quickly between what we shot a couple nights ago to the explosion that we're shooting tonight.
We're using about eight 8-ounce bombs and about 20 gallons of gas and about 20 feet of 100 grain primer cord.
Ready, and action!
For me to come back with a movie that is this big and this epic kind of and exciting and with so much tension, and at the same time gives me the opportunity to do all those stunts and all this madness that goes on, the action in the movie, also gave me an opportunity to say to my fans, I'm back.
Now give me the girl.
Not today.
It's funny, Arnold has always been bigger than life whenever you see him in movies. And in real life, he's bigger in life, but he's really personable. So he's a real person in life. But at the same time, he's not intimidating. He's sometimes you work with people that are intimidating in real life, cause, like they are on the screen, and Arnold isn't.
Making a film with Arnold is a partnership. You know, there's no detail that Arnold doesn't get involved in. There's no moment where he's not adding ideas, insights. And the bottom line of it, the kind of base of it all, is a guy who is incredibly supportive.
He's sort of the head of the set. I mean, he's the big guy. He's number one. Let's not joke around.
And because he has such a great attitude and he's so funny and so relaxed, it sort of spreads.
When you first come to meet Arnold, you have your own preconceived notions, you know, I'm going to be working with a live action figure. And then you're immediately impressed with how incredibly smart he is. And his self-effacing humor.
And I don't care who you are, I don't care how long you've been doing this, there is still the moment where you roll the camera and you're looking in the monitor and you go, oh my God, that's Arnold Schwarzenegger.
I mean, there's really nothing that one can do that is more fun at 4 a.m. than being crucified. But so he was not the only one, okay. I have not done a movie for 2 years. I had the heart surgery and all of those things. So it was important for me to come back and to show to the fans that I can do all the action, I can do all the stunts, and that I'm athletic as I always was, because they were very concerned after the surgery, you know, would I ever be able to come back, because I got thousands of letters, so I know the concerns that the fans had. And I think by seeing this movie, the fans will see that I have more energy than ever before, and that I'm back bigger and better than ever.